5 million residents. This is despite an amount of 172 million rand having been paid upfront to a service provider in contravention of the Municipal Finance Management Act for the delivery of fire engines which have not yet been delivered. To make matters worse, the specifications upon which this corrupt procurement was made do not meet the operational requirements of the EMS, which is the Emergency Management Services. To date, not a single fire engine has been delivered to the city. Only 19 auxiliary services vehicles were delivered, and these do not meet the specifications of the EMS department and are currently being retrofitted at an additional and unbudgeted cost of 48 million rand to suit the requirements of EMS. Emergency Services Department now requires 330 million to ensure that procure proper fire engines for all the fire stations in Johannesburg. This would adequately equip fire and EMS to deal with the fires and any threats around the city. This corruption and maladministration will not go unpunished. We have already acted against two senior officials who are on suspension pending disciplinary process for this misdemeanor. We have also noted serious instability in the service and its management, and will in due course fill the vacant position of Chief of EMS and the Director of Operations soon. The Johannesburg Metropolitan Police Department is another critical area of service delivery in the city. We are intending to create a safer city, as this is one of our priorities as the government of local unity. Again, as the Mayor of Johannesburg and the MMC of Safety, we have held several meetings with the senior leadership of JMPD. The MMC has unfortunately been captured in one of those meetings in a secretly and manipulated recording calling for action to be taken in the interest of JMPD. The senior management of JMPD has not had a management meeting for over 2 years. So therefore, operational, financial, and governance decisions have been taken unilaterally without support and buy-in of senior management within the organization, who must command and deploy units to duty. There's been blatant and illegal political interference in the JMPD to suit and serve the office of the mayor and its political allies. There has been an abuse of JMPD resources and members to protect and escort councillors and private citizens who neither qualify nor deserve such services. Only this morning, my office received a further letter of grievance from the JMPD citing allegations and cases lodged against the Chief of Police in April 2019 that were left unattended despite the city's appointment of a legal firm to investigate and report on these allegations. Ladies and gentlemen, there seems to have been political interference to frustrate the investigation, thus rendering the process and expenditure on the legal firm appointed fruitless. JMPD has an annual expenditure budget of 5.7 billion, and not a single contract is in place for the services rendered to the JMPD. All these services and supplies to the JMPD have been procured using what the city relies on, which is Regulation 32, using contracts of other municipalities to procure goods and services. This is a major risk and the evidence of collapse in planning, financial management, and governance. Furthermore, our officers on duty are without critical equipment such as radios, torches, handcuffs, uniforms, and firearms to meet operational requirements. 1,500 new recruits that were paraded as having completed training have been recalled to the academy. Now, as residents of Johannesburg, we were lied to when these new officers were paraded in the end of the days of the former mayor's administration. Amongst themselves, they agreed that they were paraded and deployed without completing their training modules. The city under this previous administration deployed these officers knowing fully well that they were neither qualified nor ready to perform law enforcement duties, including points duty at major intersections. They also deployed without basic requirements such as badges, appointment cards. As such, they were unable to adequately identify themselves when enforcing law as required by legislation. this, ladies and gentlemen, we take as a serious misdemeanor. The city further has been paying for vehicles, JMPD vehicles intended for JMPD. The city has been paying vehicles intended for JMPD that have been parked and unused to the service of residents. Moreover, we are currently paying a staggering 49,000 per month for each vehicle, BMW 3 Series vehicle that patrol our highways. These are the results of illegal procurement, poor contracting practices, and unplanned and self-created emergency procurement situations. This is a part of the questionable 1.2 billion rand fleet contract tender again entered into using Regulation 32 as basis by the previous administration. The issues of fleet within the city, ladies and gentlemen, have proved to be a hotbed of corruption and malfeasance. Preliminary investigations have brought to serious light the violations of MFMA, supply chain management processes, and as a result, the fleet contracts accounts for the highest irregular expenditure in the city over the last 2 years. Moving to insourcing, we are all aware that the council took a decision in January 2018 to insource security officers and cleaners. However, we have found some serious irregularities in the process of insourcing. The initially targeted number of officers to be insourced were 2,910, based on the post available. These officers, who at the date of decision were employees of security companies and deployed to the city. Currently, we have insourced over 5,021 security officers, 2,110 more officers than the post available and the targeted number. These additional 2,110 people employed under the guise of insourcing were illegally recruited and smuggled into the city's employ without any valid and legal process of employment. This is abuse of the city's processes to meet party political ends and to create a sitting constituency whose task was to maintain the status quo in government. Currently, the city requires 320 million to pay overtime due to insourced officers from April 2018 and has a shortfall of 400 million rands to complete the insourcing process. This is money away from service delivery to cover what we call as political patronage. This has a dire impact on service delivery and was done deliberately to extend political patronage, employ friends and relatives at the expense of fixing potholes, sewer systems, and waste collection in the city. The city has never catered for the tools of trade for the said officers to render adequate service, and as such, many of these officers are ill-equipped and unsupervised in the execution of their function. To date, we've reported an increase in burglaries into the city's facilities as a result of these populist decisions that we made previously. However, ladies and gentlemen, despite the above challenges, we have sought to prioritize service delivery. Coming out of the budget quota, we just realized that we are in trouble financially as a city as a direct result of these populist policies we refer to, irresponsible management of the city in the last 3 years, including diversion of resources to meet these ends. We have in your statements further details on the actions we are taking and work we've commenced in the city to bringing back the city to focus on service delivery. Amongst others, we've introduced a war on potholes because we do realize that after the rainy season of December and January, our city has been littered with potholes, and at the moment we're focusing on feeding the 4,000 potholes in the city. This is just the beginning of a process to resurface the city and the city's roads and to make them world-class roads. We've introduced a program to clean Johannesburg. I think you'll agree with me that the north, the south, the east, the west of Johannesburg, including the inner city, is very dirty. So we've introduced a program called Cleaner Jersey, and we are committed to getting our city very clean. We've launched the social housing program in Dobsonville, and tomorrow we'll be opening a clinic, a 24-hour clinic in Ebony Park, and of course holding a mayoral imbizo to engage with our people. Lastly, ladies and gentlemen, I want to report that I have received a resignation from Councillor Devanand Maharaj, who was appointed of the Congress of the People, who was appointed the member of the Mayoral Committee for Development Planning. We've accepted the resignation as he wants to pursue further interests and join the administration. To that end, we have appointed a new member of the Mayoral Committee, a new councillor, Councillor Lawrence Khoza, who's also from the Congress of the People, who will fill the position of the member of the Mayoral Committee responsible for development. And he's sitting here on my right. I thought I must bring you so that you can see him. Welcome, Councillor Khoza. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Welcome to MC Khoza. I think he needs to stand so that the colleagues can please see him as the new MMC for development planning in the city. Thank you very much, colleagues. I'll allow for a round of questions. And I think I'll start that side and then we'll come this way so that we can get the conclusion closer off. You can just indicate with your hand, and then you introduce yourself with the name and the broadcaster or the media house that you represent. Let's start with the lady, and come to the gentleman, and then I'll come to you, madam, and then these two hands here for the first round. You may start.
The previous administration had a really big drive on dealing with undocumented foreign nationals living within the city. And I understand now with your announcement of Cleanup Jordan, would that include also tackling those who are undocumented? Because part of the reason why there was some of the issues was because there was such a huge populace within the inner city. So what's the city doing about that?
Thanks. Thank you. Nick Keller from Equality for the News. One of the things you mentioned, Mr. Mayor, you said safer city amongst the others. Now, what I want to know is, what are you doing? What are you going to do to make it sure that you're going to be safe? And then number two, you mentioned that your predecessors have rendered the city dysfunctional in many critical areas of service delivery. Now, is the mission possible to fix that? Do we have budget for that? And lastly, dozens of Johannesburg wannabe traffic officers are finding it difficult to become traffic officers. Instead, it's easy for a person from KZN Northwest to come and join the NPT. What are you going to do to fix that? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Tabitha from SABC Radio. May I just want to find out, with the portals, are you getting claims from motorists for claims for damages to their cars because of portals? If you are, how much are we looking at? And how are you planning to deal with the staff shortages at EMS and firefighters?
Thanks. From the Daily Mail. I just want to find out in terms of all the money that we need to secure for EMS as well as paying people overtime, how do you plan on securing that money? And then you had a lot of emphasis on the previous administration and the corrupt and then I just want to find out, are you planning on taking these orders for the banks then? And then
hi, I'm Tony from Business Today. I'll just add on to my colleague from David because they have a question to the legal action source. Are you there from a fraud perspective? So you say this is bordering on fraud, besides from my administration, that's a common case. And then, Jeff, can you just give us specifics in terms of the financial state of this area? Say we're on the virtual financial collapse, what is the cash flow situation? Thank you.
Thanks. Can I hand it over back to you, Mr. Mayor? Thank you very much. We are one government. We're not going to try and transcend. So we've been engaging with Minister of Home Affairs, Dr. Arun Mutani, to work with us in a multidisciplinary way to deal with issues of migration in the city. Not only focusing on the inner city, wherever you find issues of undocumented migrants. Because we don't want to appropriate to ourselves that which is not our mandate. What we found in the city is that there's a lot of illegal trading. People don't look after the environment, especially the street traders, even though they've got their organized committees. Part of the delegation of Councillor Khoza here will be to deal with land use in the city. And those who are illegally using land, we're going to enforce bylaws. So we're going to be very hard in enforcing bylaws in the city. So as a issue of undocumented migrants, we'll be working together with the law enforcement agencies, but specifically with homeowners. Safer cities. We're introducing a program that we had before called Joburg 10 Plus. So we're going to deploy a minimum of 10 officers in each ward. Of course, different wards would have different deployments. So that program is being rolled out, but the problems that we referred to at JNPD, especially around management, have delayed the introduction of that program. But we very focused that in the next 2 weeks, we'll at least be launching the first phase of Joburg 10 Plus. That's how we found out that the 1,500 are not ready, because we only need 1,350 for the 135 wards. So we could source it from there, and then we realized that they are not ready. So we're doing that. But what the plus would include building inspectors, would include environmental health officers, health practitioners, because park rangers, because in each ward, we need to ensure that not only it's crime, but any contravention of the laws and bylaws are dealt with. We are working together with the MEC for safety in the province, Honorable Maziboku, to ensure that we can align our safety strategies as it relates to safety. The city is dysfunctional. The truth of the matter is that there was a lot of talk. When you drill down to exactly what happened, you find that there's very little of really what happened on the ground. That's why the cleanliness in Josie is a problem. That's why you find lots of illegal dumping sites. You find lots of potholes. So what we're focusing on is to reverse the dysfunctionality and ensure that the city will be a city, world-class African city that we want it to be. Now, this is a very difficult question. You say the traffic, wannabe traffic officers of Josie.
Yeah.
Are finding it hard to find space
to join
Metropolis, but there are people coming from other provinces.
Someone from Johannesburg can't join.
Yeah. Johannesburg is firstly for its residents, and secondly, a cosmopolitan city and a city that attracts people from all over. Now, I can guarantee you many of you here come from outside Jews, but are working here. What we found is that there was a deliberate attempt, especially with the recruitment of the 1,500, to get people from a specific province to suit a particular political party's needs that ensured that Herman Mashaba remained in power. So he was using that as a form of patronage. That has come to an end, because everyone must have a chance to join the city of Johannesburg. Those who live in Johannesburg must get a chance to get opportunities, not only at JMPD, at EMS and all the departments of the city. So the so-called political patronage has come to an end. Let me leave it there. Are we getting claims for potholes? I'll have to go get how much has been claimed so far, but you know there's a policy that you can claim. I don't have the figures with me, but we are trying to avoid that, because I think this is not a cost that must be borne by the citizens of Johannesburg. Let's fix the potholes so that people can claim the annual potholes. So we can come back to you later, or we can speak to me about how much. Staff shortages at EMS will be filling the vacancies. We'll be going out, because these are services that the people of Johannesburg will need on a daily basis. So we'll be filling the vacancies in Johannesburg. How do we act to, you say, how do you plan to act on the, what was the question again? Yeah, how are we going to get that all that money? We have to make hard choices. We sit in there and making trade-offs. And these choices we have to communicate to the people of Johannesburg, because we have to prioritize priorities. Now, what are our priorities? Our priorities are what we call the daily lived experience of the citizens of Johannesburg. Every day, when engaged with our services and service of the city, we must have a positive view of them, and we must have a positive experience of the cities. So we are not going to get money from elsewhere. You know that even the local government envelope is from national transfer is tight. So we're going to be making hard choices. But what are we going to be pushing? At the moment, finance is collecting about 89% of what they did, against the target of 94%. Now, 5% not collected amounts to about 2 billion rand. It's a lot of money. So we have to focus our efforts, which is what I was saying to Councillor Matongo yesterday, that my efforts and the mayor's are going to lean on you to ensure that we improve the collections and we can collect the money to service the people of Johannesburg. We will be taking action, legal action, against those we find responsible, especially those at Fleet, those who've contravened the MFMA, those who've prepaid a service provider for fire engines that have not been delivered, those who, under the guise of insourcing, they brought their friends to be employed without following process, and whether their political administration would have no eyes. And those who've illegally been driving councillors in cities' cars who are not deserving of being driven on being escorted, again, we take action against them. So we are going to take action and legal action where required. We're working with our forensic unit, with General Sibiya, who came to brief us about the Fleet issue in December already, and the report is not a very good report. There'll be more that we'll unveil later that have been happening under the former mayor's watch. Now, City Power is reducing its revenue budget by 720 million rand. But they're not reducing their bulk purchases. So they're losing electricity. That's what was reported to us now. They're operating on an overdraft of about 3 billion rands, which money must be sought from somewhere. We are collecting 2 billion rands less. So we don't have the necessary liquidity to do what we want to do. We are not spending on some of the grants. The National Treasury has called us and threatened to take back the public infrastructure grants. They've actually written a letter. We're trying to say to them, no, we are mitigating and we are spending. They were saying we are not spending our urban settlements development grant. We're trying to speed up spending on human settlements. So generally, we might be losing money that we don't have, that is needed for service delivery. And I think we're correct in the previous years that what we see is not what is, but our focus now is to turn around the finances of the city.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Could I take a last one, and thereafter we'll close it. Okay, I'll start with Fukato. Okay, I'll come back to you. Then I'll go to Oh, Mali, and then I'll go to the lady at the back, and the lady sits down next to the level there, the two ladies. And then there are 10 soldiers. I'll start with you, then I'll end it back at Cloudy in the same thing. Oh, okay. I'll start it there with the 10 soldiers yourself, and then I'll end it the side. Thanks.
What happened is from the soldier. Mayor, you use the word unfortunate when you refer to the MMC director. Are you using it because you are admitting that she shouldn't have made those orders to the HOD? That's the first question. And Mr. Mayor, you speak about political interference in Mr. Mashaba's administration. Would you not say that MMC giving the orders to show your muscles and suspend Dembe today is exactly that? It's political interference. Would you not say this? And I mean, the meeting, the audio that was captured is 4 hours long. I've listened to all of it. And exactly 1 hour, 20 minutes into the audio, the MMC, a tea break was taken. So these firefighters, officers, were airing their grievance. 1 hour, 20 minutes in, they take a tea break. And then this conversation between the MMC and the HOD in Sibu. The meeting had not been finished. Would you not say that the decision to then suspend Dembe was premeditated? Because, I mean, how do you make a decision before you hear all the grievances? So that those are some the first questions that I would have on that outcome.
Okay, thank you. No, yes. Oh, sorry, it's
Mbali, Mayor, I see that you've named a whole host of problems that you say you have found in the city of Johannesburg since taking up office. I just want to find out, what have you done in the short space of time which you have stayed in this office to better the lives?
roadshow. In fact, the MMC came to me and said, look, I had a meeting with the senior managers, and there's a host of complaints that allegations they are making and grievances that have been put against the chief of police. I said, hang on, because I am actually on a roadshow to visit all departments and entities in the city, just to have a dipstick in the temperature, to feel the temperature of the city, and at least the senior managers. So when we arrived in the first meeting, of course, the meeting was very tense amongst themselves, and I was a bit worried that you can't have your armed officers in such a tense situation. So we postponed the meeting for further information. But I just say that the chief did not attend the second meeting, and all the senior managers, we still have their presentation, by the way. And the issues were raised, they're very scathing. They actually concerned me as a mayor of Johannesburg that we can't have instability at our police department. So I then had a conversation with the city manager to say, how do we stabilize the MPD, and how then do we take resuscitate that investigation, because it either proved true or be dismissed, because there was an investigation started using a firm, a legal firm in the center, and that's why we say in our statement that we don't know what happened to the investigation. And we wanted the investigation completed. So what then happened, and the gravity of what the MMC was hearing, which is what she explained to me, was that she thought, in the best intention, was that maybe to allow the investigation to continue unhindered, the best way is to plead with the which is normal. I can always go to the city manager and say, I'm not taking with this department, please make sure that we investigate. But while we investigate, let the person step aside. Of course, the process must be followed. Tembe was hired by council, so there must be a report to council that must process the suspension, if at all, and then the process must be followed. So I don't think that the suspend today was correct, but the plea to say, can we be given a chance to understand what is happening with JMPD and to restore stability to JMPD does not mean that you fire somebody. From the problems we've had, it's worrisome. It's very worrisome. And that's why even in 2 months, we would have announced drawback 10 plus. I mean, on the 4th of March, I'll be 3 months in office. They've not even moved an inch because of the management problems that we have at JMPD. And it's dysfunctional. I mean, you had a director of X being sidelined and somebody acting in their positions, but while they are still at work. It was a mess. It was an absolute mess. I mean, the details I don't want to deal with here, subject to investigation. So when you say I must come clean, it's exactly that there's dysfunctionality, and it's something that we must further investigate and deal with the processes. But it might mean that, which is what the MC's preference is, that while we do that, we ask him to step aside. But that process has not started yet. Is that political interference? No. MMC must provide leadership, must provide guidance, must ensure stability. What we've delegated to the MMCs includes stability and functionality of the department. Now, if I have to hold the MMC responsible, the MMC must account on the stability of management, which is why when you appoint a head of department, the MMC is part of the interview process. So it's not political interference at all. I think it's exercising the leadership role. It might be that, as you say, it was premeditated. I don't think so, because it was not the first meeting that we're talking about. What have I done to better the lives of the citizens of Johannesburg? We've rolled out our sleeves, and I think we've invited you to come and feed the courtroom with us in Marlboro and Sandton. We're dealing decisively with crime and crime in the city, especially the debt. We are reallocating, as we try to do in the budget, to focus on service delivery issues in the city of Johannesburg. And then tomorrow we'll be in Region A, Ivory Park, launching a clinic, and after we'll be calling the mayor and Mbizo to talk to the people so to understand what their pain points are. And we'll be doing that throughout the city, including in the suburbs. We do say in our statements that all the wards are important, from Ward 1 to Ward 135. There's no ward that's unimportant to us. Of course, there's a bias towards those wards that have got backlogs. For us, we are focusing on improving the lives of people. And I think in the last 3 months, I didn't even have a December because I was in the city working. I didn't go home. Even my home is in Brockville, but I was busy working for Christmas. We were working ensuring that the city is clean. And firefighters that were dismissed, that's a labor relations issue. I know the union and the management are dealing with the issue, and I've left it as such. We believe that we have capacity, but when we met the management of EMS, they were very resolute that they will never allow anarchy in their ranks, and I didn't want to enter the space because when you interfere in labor relations matters, and unduly so, they do catch up with you later. So I think we have capacity. Wherever there are gaps, at the conclusion of the case, we'll deal with the matter of the firefighters in Johannesburg. Lungile says, is JMPD controlled by outside forces? Outside the administration. We think that the mayor and the former MMC were not firmly in charge of JMPD. Somebody else was. We are cutting that cord. We are cutting the oxygen. We are taking firm charge of JMPD now, and the investigations they are talking about are part of it. So as we speak today, there is no outside force that controls JMPD or any other department in the city. There's only one center, and the center is the government of local unity. Moving forward. I've come to the city power and the mitigation. Look, wherever possible, because city power gets power both from Eskom and from Kelvin. And around 2014, 2015, we started mechanisms to empower, to get city power to be able to reduce the load, you know, things like ripple relay, where they can switch off your geyser remotely. So whenever there's a load, they'll switch off your geysers without even you noticing that your geyser has been switched off. And they use smart meters to control the loads and all that. So they can mitigate load shedding. Yes, we'll support city power to ensure that the city stays on. We are looking at other mechanisms, including what was announced now by the president for cities and towns to self-generate electricity where possible. So that we're talking to city power about it now because it's something that we look forward to. However, what is more important to us is that the poorer areas of the city are Eskom supplied. So where is Eskom supplied? Orange Farm is Eskom supplied. Ivory Park, Deep Slope. And when you say I'm keeping the lights on, whose lights are you keeping on? So we have to answer that question. How do you still keep Soweto on? How do you keep Ivory Park on? How do you keep Orange Farm on? But yes, we'll support city power to mitigate the impact of load shedding. We are engaging with the property owners of Alexander. We had started the process, the statement of intent. I was there before elections when the president came. The president formed a ministerial task team to deal with issues of Alexander. The city was participating, but not a full participant, but now working together with the national government. On the 16th of December, incidentally, there was a meeting hosted by the Minister of Human Settlements and Water and Sanitation, Minister Sisulu. We sat to discuss, amongst other plans, how to decant Alexander. We're working together with the province, national, and Wits University to see the possibilities of using that Wits land around Alexander. So we have plans for Alexander, and we'll be doing something for Alexander. About 200 million rands will be lost, Claudie, of grants. But we are mitigating. We are reaching out to National Treasury, to Minister Mweni, and pleading that we should not lose the money. Are we budgeting for austerity? No. We are just making difficult choices and trade-offs. The time of milk and honey are gone, but we're not belt-tightening as yet. What we're doing is we're managing the surpluses, we're managing the margins of what we take into next year, and then trying to mitigate cash flows and revenues into the outer year. So the city will still be spending, but of course spending will be managed in such a way that it benefits especially the poor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Mayor. Thank you very much, colleague. Can I just request that you all ensure that we've signed into the register? And just as a matter of working together going forward, please feel free to engage with us at all times. Our doors and phones are open, and at all times, please feel free to contact us and engage on matters that affect the city. But other than that, thank you very much.